Hi everyone! Let's talk about speech accessibility in games from the perspective of a person who stutters. My name is Pat and I'm a developer tester at Alpha Channel. We're developing a narrative-rich, vehicle-based single-player game called Tankhead. I'm also a part of the amazing team of disabled accessibility consultants at PlayAbility, where I cover the speech part of accessibility. And above all, I'm a full-time person who stutters, who is interested in everything speech and communication related. It wasn't until I joined the American Institute of Stuttering in 2021 that I was able to speak so openly about it, so let me give a huge shout out to them. This speech wouldn't be possible without you. In this talk, we'll take a deep dive into stuttering in games. But not the kind of stuttering that you can fix by buying a better GPU or lowering graphics settings. This talk will be about communication and communication challenges when playing multiplayer or co-op games from the perspective of a person who stutters. So, what is stuttering really and how it affects communication in games? Stuttering is a multi-layered and multi-dimensional topic. On the surface, it can manifest as repetitions of words or syllables, prolongations of sounds or blocks. This may be accompanied by secondary movements like tensing up or running out of breath while speaking. Those are so-called overt symptoms of stuttering, but there's more to it. Stuttering is usually accompanied by feelings of guilt or shame about not being able to speak like people who don't stutter. This leads to avoidance of speaking situations or avoidance of speaking certain words that we may perceive as difficult, substituting words for easier ones, or stressful anticipations of incoming stutters. It's important to know that every person stutters in a different way, even when our conversation partners may not see or hear it. It is a very wide spectrum. Like, right now, my speech is very prepared and very controlled, so I expect fewer interruptions than during a casual conversation. So, how does it affect communication in games? Stuttering imposes certain limitations, physical and mental. When it comes to physical limitations, it simply may take us more time to communicate, because words can get stuck or the message can be distorted by the stutter. When it comes to mental limitations, we experience stress that goes up with the stakes, like when playing a fast-paced multiplayer shooter, or we avoid saying difficult keywords, which means that the team may not get precise information on time. This cements negative feelings about our speech and who we are as a person, which can lead us to avoid using the microphone entirely or falling back to other means of communication, if there are any. Why speech accessibility matters in games and who is it for? There is a screenshot on this slide from Operation Tango showing a puzzle with a timer that has run out. Let me tell you about how I got into speech accessibility in the first place. One evening, I was playing Operation Tango with my partner. It's a game in which one person takes on the role of a spy and the other person is a hacker. Each player sees something different on their screen, something that complements what the other person can see on their screen. Both need to coordinate actions in a given time frame. We're on the mission, the stakes are high, the clock is ticking. All I have to do is to relay a 4-digit code to stop a speeding train and we're done. But I can't. The words get stuck. I know exactly what I want to say, but I physically cannot get the words out. Then the timer runs out. The train performs an unscheduled barrel roll. We have to repeat the mission. Now, this wasn't a question of skill for me, but rather of the limitations imposed by the game that make the experience stressful and the game unenjoyable at times. Now, communication is the basic building block of multiplayer and co-op games. It's in the name, cooperation. To be successful, players must work together towards a single goal, synchronize actions, give orders, provide feedback. Speech accessibility often stops at having a working voice chat or a simple text chat. I talked to some of my stuttering friends about their experience playing multiplayer games, and we all agree that communication is important. Coordinating with your teammates effectively and in a timely manner is the best way to win a game. But communication doesn't have to be verbal. There are different tools that can either substitute or enhance it. Here's a screenshot from Left 4 Dead 2 showing cooperation in action. One player signals to the team where to find ammo. So, who are those tools for? The short answer is everyone. It's for people who cannot communicate verbally. It's for people who choose not to use voice or text chat at a given moment because of external or internal factors, like being in a noisy room or feeling shy about speaking up. It's for people who cannot express themselves in a fast and accurate manner. Before we look at communication tools that help, let's talk about what ruins fun. One, voice chat only. Voice chat is the default communication accessibility option that gives a tactical advantage and makes the game more engaging, but if it is the only option available for communication, many voices won't be heard. When teammates don't coordinate, sessions may get more chaotic, and those that don't speak up will feel excluded. This is a screenshot from Operation Tango's main menu that displays a message, "This game requires voice chat." Two, busy text chat. Text chat is the only other feature that allows for complex communication exchange, but it comes at a cost. Typing out messages takes time, and instructions may come too late. Communication is further hindered if the text chat window is too small, or when messages are displayed along frequent game log updates with no filter available. Here is a snapshot of a very busy text chat from World of Warcraft. Three, afterthought accessibility features. Slapping an accessibility feature on an almost finished game or a feature that is not well integrated within the game never works. One example of that could be a ping system which fails to highlight where our cursor is pointing precisely, but prioritizes different objects in the vicinity instead. The screenshot is from Rainbow Six Siege, showing the reticle aimed at a player, but the ping system prioritizes the barbed wire gadget nearby. Four, timers. Timers are supposed to increase tension and challenge. Time constraints are an inherent part of multiplayer, so PvP or PvE games. It's the nature of the genre. But timers in co-op games are very often a deliberate choice made by developers to introduce constraints. If those timers cannot be extended or are not optional, the game is likely to become unplayable for some groups of people. The slide features a screenshot from Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes, showing a bomb with different modules and a timer. What makes me feel included? One, optional restrictions, and especially optional time restrictions. A portion of players, regardless of where they fall on the speech ability spectrum, want to discover the game's story and enjoy its mechanics without rushing. Having the option to extend time or disable timers altogether makes this possible and also makes the game more accessible for a wider audience. The slide features a screenshot from a mod for Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes, showing an option to extend the timer beyond what the original game allows. 2. Well-integrated, quick-to-use communication tools, like voice lines or ping systems. Voice lines allow players to give simple commands like go right, warnings like sentry ahead, or other information that makes it easier to coordinate and interact with other players without using a voice chat. Bonus points if those commands have voiceover, like in Team Fortress 2. Now, ping system, if well integrated, can be an effective tool for drawing attention to a place, an object, or entity in a game. Some games employ a more expanded ping system, like in League of Legends, where you can additionally ping UI elements. The image on the slide shows two ping wheels used in League of Legends with various different types of pings for different situations. 3. Community. And I cannot stress enough the importance of an understanding and involved community. Playing with people who strive for successful cooperation by being friendly, understanding, and patient makes us feel included and eases the stress of speaking up. On the contrary, toxic teammates are what drives us away from a given game and also from speaking up in general for fear of being mocked again. Other tools that are very much community-driven are emotes, like dancing or playing instruments together, and using universal gestures like crouch or wiggle to signal friendliness. The slide shows a screenshot from Team Fortress 2. Heavies from red and blue teams have their melee weapons equipped and crouch to show friendliness. In the middle of the group are sandwiches that they threw on the ground. And 4, when a game is designed with accessibility in mind in the first place. Complexity of gameplay should always be matched with the respective amount of accessibility, be it in design or accessibility options. Here, my award goes to It Takes Two. The game is easy to understand, the sequences of events are clear, and the game gives you time to coordinate actions in between and doesn't punish you for failing. Pause is often available, is always available if you need to stop the action to communicate in peace. Split screen also makes it easier to understand the second player's situation. Here is a screenshot from It Takes Two, where the person on the right operates a big toy dinosaur that's moving platforms for the player on the left to cross. And that's it for this talk. Thank you so much for listening. This talk was based on my research into speech accessibility in multiplayer and co-op games. That resulted in an article posted on Game Accessibility Nexus, a website focused on accessibility in video games led by the amazing Antonio Martinez. If you'd like to introduce some more speech, hearing, vision, dexterity, or cognitive accessibility to your game, check out the PlayAbility website and leave us a message. And if you have any further questions about the talk or want to continue the conversation, reach out to me via email or LinkedIn. I'd love to hear your thoughts. Thank you so much.